you ever made a mistake about a person? You know, had that first impression about somebody that you based all your information because you thought, oh, you know, that person just, they don't understand, you know, they just don't have a clue about what I do for a living. You know, I'm a rough and tumble kind of guy, you know. I work hard for my money. But that preacher, you know, he just sits back, you know, at his desk and probably just sits around and writes sermons all day, you know, and doesn't have a clue what I'm doing. Matter of fact, I don't think he's worked a day in Dave. I don't think that he's worked. How does that expression go? I don't think he's worked a day in his life for a living. I love those kind of judgments. Those overwhelming assessments that we make. Sometimes it can be in other areas, like, oh, I don't know. Somebody takes a look at some beautiful woman and says, oh, well, she's vain. Or some other woman who, like J. Burnham D. used to say, well, if the barn needs paint, and paint it. And says, oh, well, she's, you know, don't want to talk to her. Man has a tendency of looking on the outward things. But, you know, God looks on the heart. This day, today, we've been sharing as the weather has changed outside from when it was first cold and I sat down with my kind of frumpy clothes and I had my other hat on. And, you know, and then I got to thinking about it and praying and the Lord said, you know, put on your other hat. So I put on this other hat and talked about it. And so as the day progressed and it got warmer, God said, put on your work clothes from your last job. And I said, well, okay. I didn't know why until I kind of looked at the devotional and then I thought, that makes sense. Because you see, someone like me, I've had an opportunity to have lots of jobs. And the last job I was on was hard work. I got paid a lot of money to do it. And I was started off as a fire watch. And within, oh, I don't know, about the time that I got tested to be a fire watch, I got promoted to a boilermaker. And then from boilermaker, I became a journeyman boilermaker. And that's kind of a fun job. Then from that, I got promoted to a safety coordinator, you know, for on site. And picked up my OSHA 10 for California and was able to work in that kind of hard environment. I used to pull, oh, I don't know. What do? We do 10 12s, usually. Sometimes it was longer, sometimes it was shorter. Mostly it was about 10 12s. We'd go into a mill or a powerhouse and we'd work 10 days straight, 12 hours a day. Sometimes a little longer, sometimes, you know, at least 11 hours. But, it was hard work, and it was fun, and I enjoyed it. Made a lot of money at it. But the point being, I was no different then than I am today as I share and relate to the Word of God. Because when I was allowed that opportunity to work, you know, I used the funds, you know, really to pay for the publication of my first book. And that was a blast, you know, it was a joy. And so when it came time to leave that environment and stop working that way, I was thrilled. So was my family, because my family, my sisters particularly, not my wife or not Lori, but my sisters had seen me dying in a hospital bed. And though they never really came too often or had seen that, they'd seen me before I went in the hospital and had been down to 80 pounds and 90 pounds. So they'd seen me disabled and different times trying to work and then being disabled and trying to work and being disabled. They were shocked when I'm working a big brawny job, you know, and able to do it because the Lord my God was with me. And I went from basically a scrawny 120 to 140, kind of fluctuated between there, to boom, up to 180. Man, you know, I was getting a little tough and struff, you know. I was able to strut my stuff. But you see, God doesn't care about those things because those are in the world. The accumulation of goods, the ability to work or not work, whether you are in the heights or the depths, you're going to change. God is going to take you and move you into different circumstances and situations so that you would be better equipped and able to encourage someone that maybe is disabled, that I could say to them, hey, I've been there. Or some guy comes out and says, hey, you know what? I worked on a union job. And I'll say, you know what? So did I. As a matter of fact, I was a certified checker up in Alaska, you know, for a while. And I worked with the Union of Certified Grocers, or Union UFCGW, or whatever it was called, UFCW, something like that. And I know what union dues are. And then I worked with Industria, where I was the non-union labor that came in and worked when the mill was shut down or the powerhouse. And we came in and did the work. And whatever needed to be done, we did it. And if we couldn't do it, we fabricated with welders and you name it. It was a lot of fun. I enjoyed it. And then I've been in the fields picking potatoes, you know, with the migrant workers. I drove a potato truck and I worked a sorter. So I know what a sorter is and I know what dirt clods are when it comes to picking potatoes. By golly, done that too. But God wants everyone to not judge one another. Because he said, judge not, lest you be judged. For with what measure you judge, you shall be judged. Because, you see, someone like me, you could never judge me because you don't know me. You can't see how I'm disabled. You can't see what afflictions I've had or what afflictions could still kill me. Can you? Of course not. I have an ileostomy. I have a bag on one side that I was given, gosh, you know, 30 years ago at least. And it was with me all the time of my life that I was trying to work and not working and working. And no one knew. And I would hide it very secretively. And yet, I would still be able to produce and to do the work that I needed to do. And likewise, I have Crohn's disease, or quote unquote, I've been cured, or have I? I have that ability that God, when he chooses, allows me such great health and wealth and ability to be free from disease, while at the same time, when he wants me to, I have been afflicted by that and caused me to nearly die 3 times. And so when a person tells me, oh, I'm dying of this or dying of that, been there, done that. But there's one reason why God wants you and allows you to go through all the circumstances you have gone through today, all the things that you're going through tomorrow, and possibly all the things that you've gone through in your past. It's because, say, look at these safety glasses and remember, boy, I used to have to put them on all the time. I don't have my earplugs in. I want to hear God speak. But it's because God wants you, who you are, to share with someone else the same comfort, the same consolation, the same peace and love and forgiveness and mercy that you were given with someone else. It's that simple. Boils down to really not going to a mega church and trying to start a mega church. Boils down to you having a one-on-one relationship with God so you could have a one-on-one relationship with one other person. Because you see, it's all about one. It's not about the church. It's not about this religion we call Christianity. And it's not about thousands of people getting saved at evangelism, outreaches, and ministries, and everything else, which are nice, you know, and praise God for them. But it's about one person, Jesus, and one person, you. When you asked Jesus into your life, God came and spoke to you, and he made you into becoming born again. And you were born not of the flesh, but of the Spirit, and God began to work on you, one-on-one. And you participated with him by reading the Bible and programming your mind and changing your attitudes and developing a perspective that's more like Jesus. And he began to reveal himself more as you did that. And you began to say, hey, you know, I like this idea. Then you started going around other people that were the same way, and it kind of felt like, wow, this is cool, you know. But it still started with one, and it's going to end with one, because you have one person, really, that God wants you to share with somewhere, somehow, some way. Might be your wife, might be your kids. Who knows, might be someone that's yet to be born, that you might be the one that you're raising them up as a godly son or daughter. But the point is, you have one person that you can share with. Matter of fact, you have one person you could do that today, but we won't go there. You have one person that you could share something with, that you have something in common with, that you, because you're a Christian, was able to go through because you were able to do it with God. And they're out there without God. So because you were with Him and He gave you His Spirit, He also gave you a commission. He gave you a commandment and also a decision to make. And that was, will you help someone with the same thing that you have to get through what they're going through because you've been through it? That is the Great Commission. It's not about sharing the gospel, but it is sharing about some good news. And the good news is that because you've been there, you can share it with someone else. That's what your commission is. The unheeded secret. My kingdom is not of this world. John 18:36. The great enemy to the Lord Jesus Christ is the present day, is the conception of practical work that has not come from the New Testament, but from the systems of the world in which they think endless energy and activities are insisted upon, but they do not promote the private life one-on-one with God. The emphasis is put on the wrong thing. Jesus said, "The kingdom of God comes not with observation, for lo, the kingdom of God is within you." It is a hidden, obscure thing. An active Christian worker too often lives in the shop windows. He wants to be seen, he wants to be heard, and he wants to be known by everyone around him that he is a Christian. It is the innermost and the innermost that reveals the power of the life that is committed with God and that lives in God and that has God in it. Where is your attitude at? And you'll know if the kingdom of God is within you. We have to get rid of the plague of the spirit of the religious age in which we live in. And it is our Lord's life, and it is in our Lord's life that we find the answer. Our Lord's life, there was none of the press and rush and tremendous activity that we regard so highly nowadays, and the hype and the buzz of the worship experience in the mega churches or the campus churches, in the internet, or in our desire to hype ourselves, to feel His presence, to know, as some have been doing recently, the gold dust, to speak in tongues, to do the prophesying, to be the prophet or the apostle, to exercise some ability. No, that's not what Jesus was about. As a matter of fact, you don't see that in His life. The central thing about the kingdom of Jesus Christ is a personal relationship to Himself, in the same way that He had a personal relationship with His Father. Because it wasn't the things that He chose to do that He did, but He chose to go to His Father long before sunrise to see those things that He saw His Father doing and to discuss with Him what it was that God would have Him to do. It was not His public usefulness to men that was of most import, but rather we have recorded those times where He went to the person one-on-one and they became saved. Where the thousands came and saw miracles and experienced them but went away. But the ones that stayed, the ones that kept to His faith and followed Him were the ones who had received from Him one-on-one a personal relationship. It is not its practical activities that are the strength of this Bible training college that we put ourselves through in this thing called life, but it is the whole strength that lies in the fact that you are here on this world to soak in and to know God in a personal and intimate way, to have a relationship with Him one-on-one, you and Him. God is going to engineer your circumstances, no matter what they are, with no knowledge of what strain is going to be put on you either at home or abroad. And if you waste your time in overactive energies instead of getting into soaking in the time with God and being alone with Him, then you're going to miss the great fundamental truths of God's redemption and why He saved you and allows you to go through the circumstances of life that you're going through. Why He puts upon you a hard hat, or a soft hat, or no hat, or causes you to go through sufferings, or causes you to become who you are. You will snap when the strain comes if you have not spent time with God alone and discovered that in Him you find your strength. But if this time of soaking before God is spent in getting rooted and grounded in Him, and you alone with God hear His voice, then on the practical line you will remain true to Him no matter what happens, irregardless of whether you have a job, a profession, an obsession, or a direction from God, whether you know what He designed you for or you don't. Because the one-on-one relationship that He's brought you through is your life witness of what you are that you share with one other person. You may be called someday to sit in front of a camera and do the same thing that maybe I'm doing, or maybe others that are more qualified, supposedly, are doing in great ministries and great television evangelism programs. Or you may be one that just simply never does anything else except for shares with one little child who happens to be your daughter or happens to be at a Sunday school or wherever it may be that you told them about Jesus. Because you see, man is always going to look on the outward things. He is always going to go by numbers, by images, by perspectives, even as I'm sure that people are shocked to see me dressed as this in my last job that I worked at, you know, in the world, you know, as a journeyman boilermaker, which wasn't so many years ago. And they could call me back still. Not that I think I'd go, but who knows, I like working that way. But at the same time, I'm a geek. I have a network engineering degree. I work on the computers. You know, I've set up networks. You know, I've been on teams where we opened up casinos. You know, and it was wonderful. But likewise, I've been the man who camped out overnight in a vacant church to protect the sound equipment so that no one would break in and steal and rob or destroy. I've been a missionary. I've been all those things that I saw the need, and God said, go, and I said, okay. So don't be surprised that God can use you in any way He chooses. Because if you're willing to be like a Paul, He may take your life, and in whatsoever situation you're in or circumstance, He may use it that you might become to all men, all things, lest by any means, one person might be saved by just you sharing what you've been through and how you went through it with the help of Jesus in your life.